Today on Earth Focus, many of our food crops depend on honeybees for pollination. But bees are disappearing, and now there is new evidence why. Coming up on Earth Focus. Honeybees, the essential pollinators for many of our major crops, have been dying off in massive numbers since 2006, and they are continuing to die. This threatens our food supply and can affect the U.S. economy, where 1 in 12 jobs depend on agriculture.
Bees really are the underpinning of an entire agricultural system. And when you pull out that underpinning or that pin, you begin to see the collapse of an entire agricultural system.
I think we're at that tipping point. I think we're 1 or 2 years away from disaster.
Evidence is growing that a new class of pesticides, called neonicotinoids, may be accelerating bee death. Pesticides the Environmental Protection Agency allowed on the market without adequate testing and despite warnings by its own scientists that they are toxic to bees. These pesticides are now used on most U.S. crops, including almost all American corn. EPA says there is no evidence to show they cause bee death if properly used. But environmentalists disagree and want neonicotinoids banned until adequate safety tests are done. With the government slow to act, and as neonicotinoid sales reap billions for industry, bees continue to die.
One out of every three bites of food we put in our mouths is directly dependent on honeybees.
That includes crops like strawberries, zucchini, apples, cherries, blueberries, cucumbers, and pumpkins. It also includes forage and hay crops that support the dairy and meat industry. Pollination is essential to local economies. California's almond industry is an example.
Almonds here are the cash crop in the state. We grow them for consumption here, and they're exported abroad. Now, almonds rely exclusively on honeybees to produce that nut each year. In fact, now it's over $3 billion a year business. Without bees, almond processors don't exist. Without bees, the ability to transport those around the globe doesn't exist. That entire food chain, from the bee to the beekeeper, to the food processor, to the trucker, all of those points of our current food system come back to the bee.
What if the bees vanish? Experts can imagine U.S. growers will be confined to just three crops, wheat, rice, and corn, crops that don't require bees for pollination. And the impact on the economy and the consumer could be profound. Declines in bee populations are not new. In the U.S., they've been slowly decreasing for some time. In the last 60 years, the number of honeybee colonies in the U.S. fell by 45%. The EPA says the prevailing theory among the global scientific and regulatory communities is that declines in the health of honeybees in general are related to complex interactions between multiple stressors, including inadequate food sources, diseases, habitat loss, bee management practices, as well as pesticides.
In the past 6 years, we've lost somewhere between 4.5 million and 12 million colonies.
Around 2006, U.S. beekeepers reported something new, something they've never seen before, sudden massive bee deaths that came to be called colony collapse disorder.
Colony collapse disorder is a situation where you have a handful of bees left and a queen, normally, or nothing. And a lot of young brood, the queen's still trying to lay, but the adults have all disappeared and flew off, going away.
The basic foragers that go out and bring the pollen back to the hive and keep the sustainability of the hive going, we're not returning to the hives.
Typically, if a hive dies, there'll be some remnants in the hive of a few scraggler bees, or there'll be, you'll see some brood, and these were just wiped clean.
The first to call attention to colony collapse disorder in the States was David Hackenberg, one of about 600 U.S. commercial pollinators. Every year, he trucks his 3,000 beehives cross-country to pollinate crops from California to Maine.
The fall of 06, with good-looking beehives in October and truck these bees south, 3 weeks later, I'm back down there, same location where we unloaded 400 hives of bees 3 weeks before that. Got in this bee yard and started looking at these bees, and there's nobody home. I mean, there's, you know, out of 400 and a couple hives, there's only 30-some that really even looked like a beehive anymore. If you got empty boxes, where'd the bees go?
I've seen it in my own operation. I've seen a significant decline in the number of colonies that I'm able to keep alive, and my honey crop this past season was the lowest in 36 years. And it reflects what's going on nationally.
According to an annual survey conducted by representatives from the U.S. Department of Agriculture and Apiary Inspectors of America, one out of every three U.S. honeybee colonies was lost during the winter of 2010-2011. But some beekeepers say the losses are much higher.
Our losses over the whole year are running anywhere from 50 to 80%. Unsustainable. If you're strictly a honey producer and this is your job, you know, you can't survive, and they aren't surviving.
Why are USDA reports so low? It could be because the online survey was based on data reported by only 20% of U.S. beekeepers, and because it included only winter and not full year losses.
That's a very narrow snapshot of when bees die. Now, when we look at that full picture, we understand that bee losses are substantial and continue on that downward trend.
EPA also has an online reporting system for bee loss, but beekeeper Tom Theobald calls it a sham because state regulators who oversee pesticide use don't have to report bee incidents. He says reported incidents don't remain in the records, giving EPA the defense that few incidents are reported. Other EPA critics say that bee incidents are either not entered into the database or are sanitized by management. When asked to comment, EPA issued a statement saying, "We are aware of no instance in which states have withheld pesticide incidents data." The agency says it has worked extensively with pesticide health and safety organizations to provide objective, science-based information about pesticides, and that we are handling incident reports in a responsible, transparent manner, and we encourage incident reporting.
It's my experience that the working level people in the EPA, for the most part, want to do the proper thing. They want to carry out their responsibilities. I think what we're seeing is a massive failure at the management level, and I think it's time to remove some of these people from their jobs.
Colony collapse disorder is not confined to the U.S. It is also reported in Canada, Europe, South and Central America, and parts of Asia. Beekeepers around the world began to connect neonicotinoids to vanishing bees. Olivier Belval says massive bee loss began with the use of imidacloprid, which in France is sold as gaucho.
Alors, les premiers cas de dépopulation importante de colonies ont été constatés sur des floraisons de tournesol qui étaient traitées avec du gaucho. Et donc, une partie importante des abeilles qui partaient de la colonie ne revenaient plus à la ruche.
In 2008, Germany's Der Spiegel reported massive bee deaths in some of the country's prime agricultural regions. While agriculture officials said the causes were unclear, many German beekeepers pointed a finger at clothianidin, which had been recently introduced in Germany as poncho.
You know, I laid awake many nights thinking, oh, what is going on here? Whoa, wait a minute. We've changed their farming, you know, we've changed their chemical program. We've gone to systemics, neonicotinoids, you know. And that's the period of time when they started getting more and more and more and more of this stuff started to be used.
Neonicotinoids are systemic pesticides that are absorbed by and become part of the plant, making all parts of it, including pollen, toxic to insects.
They are taken up by the vascular system of the plant and transferred to all portions of the plant, so that any insect that sucks or chews on that plant is affected by that insecticide.
It's a chemical that causes exposure constantly.
Neonicotinoids are related to nicotine and are neurotoxins, or nerve poisons, that attack insects' nervous systems, causing paralysis and eventually death.
Clothianidin is very toxic to bees, a level as low as 1/10 of a part per billion. 1 part per trillion can have an effect on the honeybees. And the modes of action are multiple. In some cases, they can kill the bees outright. In some cases, they can compromise their immune system. They can compromise their navigational ability, their memory.
They've been linked to disorientation, to the inability of bees to communicate, the inability of queen bees to reproduce, that is, produce the brood.
And they disrupt that delicate balance between the honeybee and its environment. They may fly out and die. They may fly out and not be able to find their way home again.
This is colony collapse disorder at its core.
The neonicotinoids imidacloprid and clothianidin, manufactured by the German chemical giant Bayer and registered for use in the U.S. by EPA, are widely used in commercial agriculture as well as home gardens. They are applied on crop seed, soil, and plant leaves. Engineered to be easier to use than older generation pesticides, they are also longer lasting and were thought to be less toxic to wildlife. But some scientists now say that neonicotinoids are more toxic to bees than the pesticides they replaced, and they linger in soil and water for years.
France banned imidacloprid in 1999, and Germany banned clothianidin 2 or 3 years later. It's also been banned in Slovenia and in Italy. And what we saw was a rebound of the bees in those countries.
But clothianidin is not banned in the United States. The Environmental Protection Agency is supposed to license or register pesticides if they meet standards for protection of the environment and human health.
The problem, however, is that EPA has cited a provision in our federal pesticide law that allows it to conditionally register pesticides. And it's that discretionary authority to allow pesticides on the market prior to having a full battery of tests to make safety determinations that is problematic.
This loophole allows companies to sell a pesticide before EPA gets all the safety data. And this is precisely what happened with clothianidin.
EPA registered the chemical without having full knowledge of what its impacts on bees would be, and said, we're going to design a study with the manufacturer, Bayer, but in the meantime, we're going to allow this pesticide on the market.
In 2003, EPA scientists concerned about the toxicity of clothianidin wanted to test the effect of the pesticide on bees exposed to treated corn and canola seed in a natural setting. Instead, EPA allowed Bayer to market clothianidin first and complete the study on its own product a year later. By the end of 2004, the study was not done. Meanwhile, clothianidin was already in use on over 88 million acres of U.S. crops. Bayer finally completed the study in 2007. Initially, EPA said it was sound, but in 2010, the agency reversed itself and found the study to be deficient. Tom Theobald saw where it fell short.
The life cycle study consisted of putting 4 colonies of bees on 2.5 acres of crops treated, the seed treated with clothianidin. What is completely disregarded is the fact that a colony of bees will forage over several thousand acres. It was the key study upon which conditional registration was granted to clothianidin, and it has failed to satisfy the requirements of registration.
EPA called for a new field study, one that may take years to complete. The EPA told Earth Focus it is working to develop suitable designs for pollinator studies and will seek independent scientific peer review of proposed approaches for future pollinator studies, a process that will allow the agency to explore more rigorous testing of pesticides and their impacts to pollinators. But for some beekeepers, this may be too little, too late.
And this is where EPA has basically gone wrong, because, you know, they were created to protect the environment. Something has gotten in the way. I mean, we've gotten somewhere, we got the cart before the horse.
When you take a situation where you know a chemical is highly toxic to a bee and bee colonies, and you allow that chemical to be put out into the marketplace without having complete answers to the impact that those chemicals are going to have on bee health and bee colony sustainability, you're not doing your job as a federal regulator.
I don't know why they're allowing clothianidin on the market. I have a suspicion, as any reasonable person would, and that is that it returns about $1 billion a year to the chemical industry.
The power and influence of the pesticide lobby is pervasive in DC. That power is strong, that influence is quite strong, both in direct lobbying and actually in campaign contributions.
Those that have the vested interests and the money are able to influence the statutory and regulatory decisions that are made. And as a result, we end up with a system that doesn't ask about the essentiality of introducing these chemicals, doesn't ask about do we need these chemicals. It says we can create a threshold of acceptable hazard and then not worry about anything else.
EPA officials deny that neonicotinoids are responsible for colony collapse disorder and told Earth Focus, "We are aware of no data demonstrating that an EPA-registered pesticide used according to the label instructions caused colony collapse disorder." According to Bayer subsidiary Bayer Crop Science, it is widely agreed among scientists that disease and parasites as individual stressors and in combination are the most relevant factors in honeybee colony loss. The pesticide industry conducts or sponsors its own studies that show neonicotinoids do not have long-term effects on bees under natural or field conditions.
Bayer is taking a play straight out of the handbook of big tobacco. That is, we will continue to create enough uncertainty around an issue that nothing happens. So what they've said is that because we cannot conclusively say this pesticide, clothianidin, causes this X bee death, we cannot do anything about it. We need more and more and years of research before we can do anything. So big tobacco did this for years and years with cigarettes and secondhand tobacco. We now see the same thing with bees and pesticides.
While the link between colony collapse disorder and neonicotinoids has not been conclusively proven, over 100 independent studies, studies not funded by the pesticide industry, show that neonicotinoids have acute, sublethal, and chronic effects on bees.
The body, the weight of evidence of studies that have come forward in the past several years, have fairly conclusively said that pesticides, both alone and in combination with other factors, are leading to this sudden bee decline or colony collapse disorder.
Two reports published in the March 2012 journal Science show what happens to bees exposed to levels of neonicotinoids found in field conditions. British researchers report bumblebees exposed to imidacloprid grew more slowly, and the number of queen bees produced fell by 85%. A French study showed that fewer honeybees made it back to their colony after exposure to the neonicotinoid cruiser. Honeybees come into contact with neonicotinoids through pollen and nectar.
But there's a third avenue called guttation. It's droplets that are exuded by the plant, usually in the morning, typical of corn, and the bees will use that as a moisture source. Those are very high in systemics and can kill the bees outright.
If you want to look at high impact exposure and look at what could be causing this massive decline in colony health, you've got to look at contaminated corn or corn that's treated with neonicotinoid pesticides.
At least 90% of the over 94 million acres of corn that were planted in the United States this year were treated with neonicotinoids. This is a substantial number, and it's on an upward trend. We see that these corn fields are one of the only places that bees can forage or find food.
You know, corn don't need bees. Unfortunately, corn has a lot of pollen. When corn pollinates in late July and August, corn pollen is flying through the air everywhere. You could go and watch a beehive that's not even sitting in the cornfield bringing in corn pollen, because as that bee flies through the air, its hair on its body is like a magnet, and it absorbs. That's the way it was developed, to go into that plant, take that pollen, get it on its hairs, move it from that plant to the next plant to cross-pollinate. So as that bee's flying through the air or visiting the corn, because the bee is looking for pollen, it's bringing back that pollen from that corn plant to the hive, loaded with lots of things.
Here we have a situation where, as with most pesticides, there's drift off the target site. And so with these neonicotinoids, what we're seeing is that actually the plants, it could be wildflowers, it could be dandelions, it could be plants along the side of the road, on the farm, by the farm, that are also picking up this chemical as a systemic and also expressing contaminated pollen.
Purdue University researchers recently found that dust exhausted from seed planting machinery carries highly concentrated doses of neonicotinoids that can be fatal to bees.
There's a lot of farmers out here today that really don't want that stuff, but they have no choices because, you know, that's the way the system has become.
When most farmers now go to actually purchase seeds from a seed supplier, they now are forced to buy seed that's been treated with these products.
This is a money-making thing. It's what's good for the seed company and the pesticide company that's making the product.
So unfortunately, insurance companies, banks, and the U.S. Department of Agriculture has promoted this acceleration of the use of pesticides on corn. They've actually created blanket insurance policies that make it easier and actually promote the use of widespread, wide-scale use of neonicotinoid pesticides. In fact, farmers can't get as good of insurance policies or rates unless they apply them.
The farmers become serfs to the system. They're working for the company store. If they use these products for more than a few years, they now have a soil that's virtually inert. If they want to grow anything, they have to go to the chemical companies for the seed, for the herbicide, for the pesticide, for the fertilizer, and if they have a crop, who do they sell it to? This is the old company store model on a grand scale.
Unless the EPA is given the opportunity and faces increased public pressure, it's unlikely that the agency will take the necessary steps to protect our bees.
And public pressure to protect the bees is growing.
Recently, over 250,000 people from across the country sent a clear message to the Environmental Protection Agency that they need to take immediate action to phase out or suspend the use of these neonicotinoid pesticides, specifically clothianidin. Now, that message from EPA back is, we're not listening.
La solution pour nous, elle est simple, c'est interdire ces produits sur les plantes visitées par les abeilles.
The precautionary principle is a principle that's followed in most of the European countries and most of the other countries, and it means that we err on the side of caution, that a chemical is not released to the market until its safety is assured. Here in the United States, it seems to be the other way around, and what the EPA and the chemical companies have done is they have turned the environment into the experiment, and the people have become the guinea pigs. We're the experimental animals.
Bees are a symptom of something larger. That's a broken federal regulatory system that fails to provide necessary protections for us and our food.
We're on a crash course with our existence. I think the bees and the demise of the bees are that message to us.
You know, are my grandkids and their kids gonna be reaping this, or are we gonna be able to fix it before that? That's, you know, I don't have an answer.
Airwaves, a global channel of uncompromising stories, world news, documentaries, entertainment, and culture. LinkTV, connecting you to the world. For more information, visit linktv.org.